Well, good morning.
Good morning.
And Merry Christmas. It's a great day to be here. Hope you already had a great Christmas day already. Wonderful to see you here one more time as we celebrate this Advent season, we celebrate the day of Christ's birth, Christmas Day. And we celebrate the joy, the light that is coming to the world, the joy that is coming to the world as we sing together. Would you stand as we begin our service this morning?
And then nature sees, and then nature sees, and then nature sees, and then nature sees.
glad you're here. We have this wonderful glorious day to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We had a wonderful time last night, and we're thankful that you're with us this morning. I want to just take the opportunity to send prayers for you guys. Would you bow your head as we go before the Lord? Our Heavenly Father, we come in the name of the Lord Jesus. May you reveal yourself and give you flesh so that we may know you, may love you, may serve you. We know that this is probably not the day that Jesus was born. And this is a day in Christian tradition that we have set aside to recognize the wonderful moment, the act of God, God dwelling with us, Emmanuel. We're so grateful that you came for us, that you entered into our world and into our lives so that we might be saved, that we might have new life, that we might know you, and that we might be able to share with others who you are. Now we thank you, Lord, for this day. We pray for every part of the service, for the songs that will be lifted up, for the message that will be shared, for the offering that will be received, for the words that will be told to one another in embrace of peace. And we pray, thank you, I have your presence in your people. We pray that when we came into this place, we became hungry and empty, needing to be filled. But when we leave from here, we'll go away with our cup overrunning with the joy of the Lord. We thank you. Thank you for our families. Thank you for our church family. Be with us now. We seek you, worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said,
amen. Amen.
I'm so glad that you're here. You'll notice that there's a welcome card or connection card at the heart of the bulletin. And I don't know that maybe some guests here for the first time, you may be here with family, you're from out of the city or out of the state or something like that, we welcome you. But you can also take the connection card, not only the list of who you are, how we can follow up with you. But if you have a prayer request or concern or something, put that in there. We can pray for you. Isn't this a great and glorious day? Isn't it? We're glad that you're here. Are you comfortable now? Are you comfortable? I hope you get too comfortable. How do we do this? Let's stand and greet each other in the Lord. Let's get stirred up for Jesus this morning. Let's love on somebody and share peace.
those days, the drug issue had increased at a 50% of the entire Roman world. A paper that told where everybody was born. They wanted to know where everybody was born. They went on the record. That's what they were taught.
You know what, I went to one of
these
facts.
That's exactly what it was. Now, this was the first thing that took place while Farida was governor of Syria. Well, Farida was governor. So Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, to the town of David.
Okay, now Joseph was ill in Nazareth. But, and that was in Galilee.
Right.
And he went all the way over to Judea, to the town of Bethlehem. I guess that's where he was going.
That's exactly right. That's why he had to go back there. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son, and she wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger. But there was no room for them to be held.
What if they just threw the holiday in?
The sheep were sleeping, some of them were, and sometimes suddenly a great trumpet of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests."
So, then what happened?
Well, when the angels had left and gone back into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go back to him and see the things that happened, which the Lord has told us."
Who did the question? Why, Father God?
Well,
I don't know, maybe. They probably killed somebody to do it.
They were simply watching.
But they were so excited about going to Bethlehem because they had never met an angel before.
They never had.
And now they had met an angel and he told them, "Go to Bethlehem." Give them the address, I know. So how were they going to find it? Maybe Jesus. Oh yeah, he said, "Go around and look for a baby in a manger."
Exactly.
I guess there weren't many babies in mangers in that day, so they were not easy to find.
That's right. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about the child. And all who heard were amazed at the at what the shepherds had said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which was just exactly as they had been told.
So that is the Christmas story, the real Christmas story. And the shepherds, I guess they were kind of like the first missionaries, weren't they? The first preachers, the first evangelists, they went told everybody about what they had experienced. Do you suppose we're supposed to do that? Are we supposed to tell people?
I'm pretty sure.
That is the Christmas story. Well, let's have a word of prayer, and then we'll go back to our seat. Father, we come to you this morning thankful for the real Christmas story, for the story that you have given us that has lasted over 2,000 years. Father, it still is true in our hearts today. I pray that each one of us would be like the shepherds and that we would go out and tell the world who Jesus Christ is and what he has done in our hearts. Father, I pray that we would be good shepherds and go and tell this world about
I'm sure I've had at least four cups of sugar. And everything that I've eaten, there's all these sweet stuff coming your way. Maybe that helps out. I want to ask you, if you would, to open your Bible and look at a few Bibles, look on someone, and look at chapter 1 of Luke, and begin with verse 39, and then we'll locate some verses in there, verses 39 through 56. Okay? I want y'all to help me out a little bit. Just shout it out. I got to shout it out because both my ears are clogged. But I want you to shout it out. What is your favorite Christmas song or our favorite Christmas hymn? Somebody shout it out for me. There it is, you know. Holy night. Silent. What is it? Jingle bells. Joy to the world. Holly in the ivy. Okay? Holly in the ivy. I don't know where I put that one. You'll sing this at the start of the same time. Holly in the ivy. Anybody else got to shout it out? Little drummer boy. Jingle bell rocks. Can you hear what I hear? Alright, this is pretty good. You know, these are some of our favorite and familiar songs and hymns of Christmas and a few that I'm learning about. But there are some of those that are not so famous songs that you might know of, but we don't often sing them. For instance, All I Want for Christmas is My Two Front Teeth. Y'all know that song? All I Want for Christmas, Two Front Teeth, Two Front Teeth. How about this? Grandma Got Run Over My Reindeer. Yeah, you know that song. Okay. We generally don't sing it in church, but it's it's good. How about this? Redneck 12 Days of Christmas. Redneck 12 Days of Christmas. Here's day five. Five flannel shirts, four big blood tires, three shotgun shells, two hot dogs, and some parts to my Mustang GT. Right. That's how I can't sing in church. I want to hit the bottom. All right, there you go. Yes, isn't it? All right, good. Well, you know, I want to talk about another Christmas song this morning that we know about, but it's not really that familiar to us. Maybe it should be. I want to bring it onto your radar. I want you to see it this morning. And, you know, we don't know the tune to it, but it's a Christmas song. It's Mary's song here in Luke chapter 1. It's Mary's song. We know the story. We heard much of the Christmas story, some of the details already. But we know that Mary was betrothed to Joseph. And in the Jewish world, if you were betrothed to someone, it's kind of like engagement where they had arranged marriages. Imagine they had arranged marriages. And so there was an arranged marriage, and the betrothal time was a time when they would have supervised visits with each other. And they get to know each other. So this was a time of engagement, but it was a binding contract. A binding contract. So if you were betrothed, you're actually legally bound in that contract. And so we have the angel announcement, and the angel shares with Mary that she's been chosen to give birth to the Messiah. Now, in all of the prophecies and all the things from the synagogue sermons, no one had ever proclaimed that the Messiah would come that way. And so here's the announcement that God is going to use her womb and be birthed into this world. And you remember what her answer was. Her answer was, Jehovah, the handmaid of the Lord, the servant of the Lord. That was her reply. Just imagine how difficult that would be. Behold the handmaid of the Lord. Well, then the real challenge was to tell Joseph. And so she goes and she tells Joseph that she's going to give birth to a child. But God had spoken to her through an angel. You can see how this is working out in his mind. And I'm sure that there was some anxiousness on his part, some disagreements, some confusion. So what we're told is sometime, maybe after that Mary went off to the countryside to the home of her cousin Elizabeth. And so she's with Elizabeth for 3 months. And this has given Chelsea some time to think things over and giving her some time to think through, because she had God's calling and she could see what God was going to do, but she didn't know how it was going to work out. And so she's at the home of Elizabeth. By the way, that's just an amazing story, because the angel told Mary that Elizabeth was pregnant with a child, 6 months pregnant. And when they arrived, an announcement was made that Mary had come carrying the child in her womb. When it was announced, the child, the 6-month-old child inside of Elizabeth's womb, leaped with joy. Put a foot right on the kidney or bladder or something. Leaped with joy. So the child leaped with joy when it heard the announcement of the Lord. It's quite amazing. So she's there, and she is working through things. When she left Nazareth, she left things in a confused state. She left her betrothed, Joseph, working things out in his mind, right? And so there she is. And we have here that she wrote a song. It is Mary's song. It is referred to as the Magnificat. Because in Latin, it says that Mary said, "My soul magnifies," and Magnificat means to magnify, a burst of glory to the Lord. Now I want us just really briefly to look at the song. I wish we knew how to sing it. Maybe Gary could come up here, or Darren could come up here, we could play a tune. But I wish we could put it to the words to song if we just knew how to sing it. But see, it's really not so much on our chart because we don't have the music. And some of you may have sung it in the past, but I've never sung these words. But what I want you to hear is that Mary writes out this song in a time of uncertainty. And really, it's almost like there's three stanzas to this song. And she's writing out her song, the Magnificat, in a time of uncertainty. Though she knows that she has the favor of the Lord upon her, and though she has submitted herself to the Lord, she didn't know how all that's going to work out. I'm going to tell you something. There are people that show up in a Christmas Day service, or Christmas finds them, and they're experiencing a time of uncertainty. I mean, if you had to write it out for us, write it out. How is it going to work out? You can detail it, there's no way. You can't see it. And that's the way it was for Mary. She couldn't see it. This song was written in a time of uncertainty. So that's why it is so extremely amazing. Because of what she says, okay? Notice verses 46 and 47. By the way, I'm going to use the Message translation. But I want you to locate this, and I'm just going to share with you very briefly what I think those two verses. First stanza. Oh, if we could just break forth in song. She's expressing the feelings in her heart. So she's writing, she's had time to write this out. To the Lord. This is her song. Her heart is filled, verses 46 and 47, with a burst of praise. Her soul magnifies the Lord. I feel like I've got too much sugar rush coming out. Y'all okay with me? Alright. Her soul bursts forth with praise. She is magnifying the Lord. Would you hear that? In a time of uncertainty, the first stanza is praise, is glory to the Lord. Now you just think about that. You're facing something uncertain. This is what it says in the Message translation. I'm bursting with good news. I'm dancing. Mary wasn't a Baptist, I'm sure she was. I'm dancing the song of my Savior God. By the way, what it's saying is that she is delighting herself in the presence of the Lord with this praise in her heart. She can't. She's on the tiptoe. She's tiptoeing and expressing her joy before the Lord, who is her Savior. Mary needed a Savior, just like we do. And it says that, come look at me and look what happened. I'm the most fortunate woman on earth. That's not bragging. That's a humble response. I'm so fortunate that of all how it's all going to work out. Then she says, what God has done for me will never be forgotten. Never be forgotten. Her name, here we are today, 2,000 years later, and we are speaking of this song and of Mary. So Mary holds herself as a servant to the Lord. Hear that in time of uncertainty. Okay? That's first. Second. Verses 48 and 49. She turns her attention to the nature, to the character of God the Savior. And actually, there are three words that really stand out, unfolded here for me to see. Three words I want to share with you. The first is the word holy. The God whose very name is holy. God's name is what? Holy. His name is holy, set apart. His name is glorious. He is God, set apart from all others. He is holy. That's why I'm here. He is holy God. But not only is holy, the second word is mercy in her song. His mercy flows. His mercy flows in wave after wave on those who are in awe before him. Remember, she's in a time of uncertainty, and yet she is saying he is holy, he is merciful, and his mercies flow wave after wave. Amen? Wave after wave. And then the third word is strength. Our God is able. Amen. Say that with me. Our God is able. Remember, she's writing this song in a time of uncertainty. Oh, we have so many songs like that in our hymn, so many songs in our times of worship that says of God that he is able. He is able. And so that's what she's doing. She says, that's great. It says, in the Message translation, it says, he bears his arm, his mighty arm, shows his strength. That's the third word. Shows his strength. He scatters the bluffing braggarts. He knocks the tyrants off their horses, full victims out of mud. He's a Savior. He's doing amazing and wonderful things. That is the nature and character of God. And she is extolling him. He is holy, he is merciful, he is strong. You believe that? So we see this. Even in this time of uncertainty, Mary's writing a song. Second stanza, Mary doesn't know how everything's going to work together. She doesn't know how it's all going to work out together for good. We know that verse. We say it all the time. Well, that's going to happen. But she just proclaims her faith. Who God is. Who he is. Now I want you to think about that just a moment. Who is God? Who is he? I know we showed up, we've got family, we've got friends, we've got things happening in this day, we've got Christmas dinner to get on the table. We've got a lot of things happening today, but listen to this. If you're facing uncertainty, focus on who God is. Because God is bigger than what you're facing. Here's the other thing. Third stanza. Ready for the third stanza? She spends most of the time describing God's grace. You know what I love about this? If you look at verses 50 through 55, the majority of this psalm is spent on the grace of God. And what I love about it, and I'm just going to read it, what I love about this is she is magnifying, her soul is looked at magnifying the Lord. She is the servant of the Lord. I don't know how it's going to work out, but God is bigger. God is able. He can handle it. I can't see. I can't see, but I know he's leading it. And then she says, but look at who God is. What he's going to do. And I think that there's some revelation about this child, Jesus, the Messiah. God's salvation and who he is. She's beginning to let it soak in. And that when it comes to grace, no one's going to be left out. His grace is going to touch anyone and everyone that will receive. The starving poor sit down at a banquet. Amen? Listen to that. We remember that. The callous rich were left out in the cold. Those who were dependent on themselves. He embraced his chosen child, Israel. So she's looking back in their history. She's thinking of a time when a nation wasn't a nation, when they had nothing and God brought them out, redeemed them, saved them, and said,
remembered and piled on mercies, piled them high. It's exactly what he promised. He promised from Abraham right up until now. That's third stanza. Mary, magnify. My soul magnifies the Lord. She's recognizing God's faithfulness, God's grace, God's salvation. So important. This says in verse 56, look at that. Mary stayed with Elizabeth for 3 months. That was up to the time that she gave birth to John, which would be John's Baptist, right? And Elizabeth gave birth. And then it says, then she went back to her own home. I'm going to tell you something. Just imagine. You ever had something waiting on you and you didn't want to face it? You know what I'm talking about? You ever had that? You had something waiting on you, something that was there, and it was so uncertain you didn't know how it was going to work out. Mary has written her song. She's singing her song all the way back to Nazareth. She didn't know what Joseph was going to be. She, by the way, is 3 months pregnant now. She's starting to show up. She didn't have that. She's starting to show up. And so she's not sure how it's going to work out. And she returned. She didn't know that sometime in that 3 month period, Joseph, who had decided that he would just divorce her quietly. Because he didn't, you know, that's something about love. He just divorced her quietly. He didn't want to bring any injury to her or to her family and this kind of thing. He just deal with it. But he had a dream. It was a vision from God. God spoke to him through this dream. And said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife. And then he reveals to him what God is doing. And that this child that will be born will be the Emmanuel, God with us. As God is doing something. And he woke up from that. And I'm sure he fell to his knees and he said, I accept this, God. And he's just pacing, waiting for Mary day after day. You know, they have Twitter. they didn't have email. They didn't have text messaging. Just wait. They didn't have to smell that one. You know what I'm saying? They just wait day after day, wait day after day. And you got the community around. She's coming back and she's saying, God, I don't know how it's going to work out. I don't know. My soul is magnified. And she's singing her song, right? Except for one. And then I think every day he's looking at it. So he says, Mary's here. And I said, so like this. Look at, and he sees her coming and I don't know how it happened. But I think he said, God, I've spoken. And in that moment, there's a song. Now, they have two people. They're saying, we trust God, we hold the service of the Lord, but there's some uncertainty. I thought it would work out. So maybe that's where you are. Just what? Every now and then. Right. So I want to read to you here now and then. And then I'll get a little application. And then we're going to go to the relationship. But here now is a song, good feeling, beautiful liturgies, nice presents, big dinners, and two words that might make Christmas. Christmas is saying yes to something beyond all emotions and feelings. Christmas is saying yes to a hope based on God's initiative, which has nothing to do with what I think or feel. Christmas is believing the salvation of the world is God's work, not mine. God's at work. We show up with uncertainty, but it says God has a plan. All right. Three words of application. Three words of application. We think about times of uncertainty. We know how things work out, you know. You know, talk about last night, Mary and Joseph, or the census, 9 months pregnant. Imagine that journey. I remember driving from Sweetwater to Abilene, Texas. My wife was saying, what just happened? I was doing a little mom, it was my first kiss. I said, breathe, baby, breathe. There's three applications, very quickly. One. When facing uncertainty, let God create your life with a new song. When facing uncertainty, let God create your life with a new song.
comfort your life on, and your life to your land. Just find that place of quiet. Statement two. When facing uncertainty, offer yourself as his own servant. I mean, everything wants to knock you off the high center. Everything wants to put you down. But if you humble yourself in times of uncertainty, he will lift you up. Amen? And then third, face uncertainty with the certainty who God is and with his courage. We're going to face uncertainty. That's just the way in life. But we never face it alone. You bow with me. It's time for prayer. Now listen to this time of invitation and then we're going to pray. What's God spoken to you in this service? Now you will know it. You will know it. He's saying something to you. Let it be in a cloak of love. Not judgment, but love. God loves you. He wants the best for you. And you're facing something. Maybe somebody, this whole message is perfect for that one person. Most of us are going to face some kind of uncertainty. So what's God said to you? Now, what does he want you to do with it? Maybe it is a time of repentance. Maybe it is a time of humble yielding of yourself as a servant. Maybe it is a commissioning. And you hear it clearly this morning when you accept it. Would you lay the burden down? Will you receive God's call? Will you let God lift you up? Whatever it is he wants to do. Then, listen. Someone here today may need to receive Jesus as their Savior. How about giving your life to Christ today? Just pray. Dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart and forgive me of my sin. Set me free from my own undoing. And give me new life in your Holy Spirit. And set my feet in the right direction so that I tell others about you. And when I die, no heaven will be my home. And as I live, I will live by faith in the Son of the living God. And this is my hope and prayer. And I receive your Spirit into my life. Now, if that's you, you may want to come this morning and have an invitation to receive the Lord publicly, except I've asked Christ to save me. But this morning, some may have received Christ, others may have laid their burdens down, others may have been recommissioned, others may have been rejuvenated. Some may have, in the midst of uncertainty, said, I will not be afraid, because my God is able. So Lord, only you can do for the miracles that you intend for this day. In Jesus' name. Amen. You stand together. Just reverently stand together just a minute. Just want to linger this time. But where you are, you may pray. Where you are, you may come forward. I pray with you. Just take a few minutes to do that. Be first.
I'm verse today comes from 2 Corinthians 9:15. Thanks be to God for His indescribable gift. Let us pray. Father, today we come to You in humbleness, knowing, Father, that You came to us first, and You came to save us. And You were born on this day, Lord, and this day started it all. And Father, we're so grateful, we're so undeserving. We're so humbled, Father, that You would do these things for us, even though we didn't deserve from You. Father, we pray that You would be with us, help us to understand all of this. Help us to grow in love for You and for the things You do for us. Prepare the way ahead, Father, so that we may follow You and then life will be safe and free. Father, we ask especially for the blessings on this church. We pray, Father, for our church finances, for our church budget. Father, pray that You bless us and open Your abundance and spill it out on us. Father, we pray for missionaries to go out and spread this word and say these things to others, especially today for Arthur Thompson. We pray, Father, that You clothe him in Your righteousness. Father, that You would teach him and give him the words that You want him to say. Protect him, Father, and give him safe travel. Father, we ask all these things in Your name. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Five years. I've found people that have been Christians a long time, never in this